بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما قال الله تعالى في كلامه المجيد والفرقان الحميد يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا بطانة من دونكم لا يألونكم خبالا وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من تشبه بقوم فهو منهم أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Respected brothers and elders, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As you know that today is the 15th of February, sorry, 14th of February, and many non-Muslims, including also Muslims, are celebrating an event known as the Valentine's Day. Now we see that we have many festivals and celebrations which are apparent in this country or in the West, and also in the Muslim countries and in the Arab countries, like Mother's Day, and Muslims also celebrate Christmas Day and Valentine's Day. If you were to look at the history behind Valentine's Day, if you were to look at the history recorded by the non-Muslims themselves, not the Muslims, that what was the history behind this particular day, behind the celebration of on this particular day, if we were to pick up the books of history and look in the encyclopedia, we would know and it would come to our knowledge that this day is attributed to a person in the Roman time known as Saint Valentine. And there have been many incidents recorded. They differ amongst themselves, but all these incidents, they all result in one thing, which is that this particular day had a connection with Christianity, with paganism, and with the Romans. Now, one of the incidents they mentioned, and this person, Saint Valentine, or Saint Valentine, was a devout Christian who was a martyr for Christianity, who gave his life for Christianity, and who was jailed. And on this particular day, he was martyred, according to what they say. And when he was in jail, he became a friend to one of the guards, the daughter of one of the guards at the jail. And then he used to write letters to her. And when he died, he wrote a letter to her on this particular date, on 14th of February, saying, "From your Valentine." This is one of the incidents which they mentioned. And also they have mentioned that there was a custom in the Roman times that on this particular day they used to have a lottery in a jar or in a box or something, they used to put the names of young children or youth, youngsters, boys and girls, and then they used to pick names, and then they used to draw out names, and the name of the girl and the boy who would be taken out, they used to stay together. They used to have approximately 2-3 weeks or a year, according to some, they could stay together, and then eventually they used to fall in love and then as a result get married. Things like that, there have been many customs. The result of all of this is that this particular day, celebrating Valentine's Day, has a direct connection with Christianity and with paganism and with ignorance, with jahiliyyah, with kufr and disbelief. Now, Muslims have been ordered, Allah in the Quran, the verse which I have recited in front of you, clearly Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِّن دُونِكُمْ لَا يَأْلُونَكُمْ خَبَالًا. That all you who believe, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً, that don't make, لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِّن دُونِكُمْ, non-believers, kuffar, non-Muslims, don't make them as bitana. The word bitana in the Arabic language, if those people who know Arabic, they would know, that is from the word batan or batin. Batin means the inside of something, whereas the zahir, for example, we have this hand, the batin of the hand is the inner part, the palm of the hand, and zahir is this part of the hand. Batin is something which is inside of something, meaning if you're wearing clothes, the inside of your clothes will be known as the batin of the, and zahir will be the outside. So Allah uses the word here, bitana, that don't make them in such a way that they are very close to you, as the mufassirun, the people of tafsir, and the commentators of the Quran, they explain that the person who is a bitana to you, meaning a friend, is that person who is sahibu sirrihi, the person who knows all your secrets, and the person with whom you have intimacy with, and the person with whom you share secrets, and you talk about matters. So Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِّن دُونِكُمْ لَا يَأْلُونَكُمْ خَبَالًا. That these non-Muslims, these believers, the kuffar, they will never fail to corrupt you. Their intention, their objective, their purpose, their goal of life is only to corrupt the Muslims and inflict harm on the Muslims. Allah says further along in the verse, He says that هَا أَنْتُمْ أُولَٰئِ تُحِبُّونَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِبُّونَكُمْ. These are you people, Muslims, you love them. وَلَا يُحِبُّونَكُمْ. But they don't love you at all. They don't love you, but you love them. So Allah says that do not make... In another verse as well, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا الْكَافِرِينَ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِنْ دُونِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Do not make the kafir close friends leaving the Muslims. Do not make the kuffar friends. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned by Imam al-Tirmidhi in his book al-Sunan, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Now when a person imitates a nation, a group of people, a person who imitates a group, a nation, then he is amongst them, he will be from them, also on the day of Qiyamah, on the day of judgment, and even in this world, he will be considered a part of them. Now here many people, a lot of people ask this question, now what do we mean by tashabbuh? Like having an imitation with the kuffar. Is everything what the kuffar do imitation we can't do? Whatever the non-Muslims do, we are not supposed to do. For example, the non-Muslims, they eat food, they sit in the cars, they eat fish and chips, they eat rice as well. Nowadays they even eat Arab and Asian food. So everything what non-Muslims do, is it prohibited? Are we supposed to stay away from it? No, this is not the meaning. The meaning, as the scholars explain, of tashabbuh, of imitating kuffar, can be in two ways. Number one is that a person practices or he does something, he carries out something with the intention of being like the kafir, with the intention, with love, that I am doing this particular act because I want to be like the kuffar, because such and such person does this, he wears something, a person, a Muslim, he wears some type of clothes and he says that he has this intention that I am wearing these clothes because I want to be like, for example, Michael Jackson, or I want to be like some football player, David Beckham, or something like that. So with the intention, or for example, for the females, they want to be like Madonna or whatever. I don't want to mention the names. But with the intention of imitating the kuffar. This depends on the intention. Now, for example, there could be two people in front of us, they're both wearing the same clothes. He's wearing something and he's wearing something same. But this person, one of them, he did not have an intention. He wore it because he saw it in the shop and he said, this looks good and it's warm and it's nice to wear it. He wears it, there's no problem, it is not a sin, and this is not prohibited. But another person wears the same thing with the intention that, yes, I've seen this certain football player, he was wearing this brand name, so therefore I will have to buy this as well and I want to wear this as well and show it to my mates. So with the intention of imitating the kuffar, with pride, that yes, I want to be like the kuffar, this is totally prohibited in Islam. And this is the meaning of the hadith, مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever imitates a nation, a group, a people, he will be with them, amongst them on the day of Qiyamah. So this is one of the ways of imitating the kuffar, with the intention. And here we can't find out. We leave it to the people. Allah knows best between the person and Allah. This is the reason why the ulama scholars say that we should not judge people by their outer appearance. We see somebody wearing something, you shouldn't say, oh, you're a fasiq, or you're imitating the kuffar. No, we leave it between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have good opinion. Husnul dhan is part of our deen. And we have good opinion about people. When you see somebody wearing something or doing something, we have good opinion that this person, his intention is correct and he has love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one way. The second way of imitating the kuffar is doing something or practicing something which is a unique characteristic of the kuffar, which is unique or which has a direct connection with the event or with the celebration. For example, Christmas. Now, we don't have to have the intention that I am celebrating Christmas because I want to be like the kuffar. No, you celebrate it whether you have the intention or you don't have the intention. It has a direct connection with the religion. Similarly, all these other days. So Valentine's Day will come into the second category, that Valentine has a direct link with the religion. So therefore, if a person has the intention of imitating the kuffar, or he does not have the intention of imitating the kuffar, it will still be prohibited. So as I mentioned, two ways of imitating the kuffar. One is with the intention of being like them, and number two is something which has a direct link or connection, and it's affiliated with their particular practice, custom, religion, etc. So as you know, as I mentioned, that in the Quran Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَخِذُوا بِطَانَةً. Many verses. In another place Allah says, أَيَبْتَغُونَ عِنْدَهُمُ الْعِزَّةِ, that the Muslims, are they looking for izzah and respect with them? Surely they will not give you respect. Respect is وَلَنْ تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَنْ نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ, that the Christians and Jews and the non-Muslims in general will never be happy with you. وَلَنْ تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَنْ نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ, until you don't follow their ways, until you don't accept their ways, their religion, and until you don't accept what they have to say, they will never be happy with you. So this has been clearly prohibited in Quran and Hadith of the, as I mentioned. In another Hadith, it has been mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in many Hadith, there's one incident mentioned in Sunan al-Tirmidhi that Umar radiallahu anhu, we look at the example of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, that how much they used to have love for the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and dislike the ways of the kuffar. There is one incident of a famous Sahabi companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He went to a certain place where there were non-Muslims, and when he went there, when he was eating, he was sitting on the floor and eating, and then a morsel of food fell from his hands and fell onto the floor. So he picked it up from the floor and he started eating. He blew on it so the dirt would be removed, and then he put it in his mouth. Another friend, companion of his, who was also a Sahabi, he nudged him slightly and he said to him, look, these people, they don't like, you know, picking up food from the ground and eating it. So this Sahabi, look what he said. He said that, أَنَتْرُكُ سُنَّةَ نَبِيِّنَا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مِنْ أَجْلِ هَؤُلَاءِ الْحُمَقَى, that shall we leave the sunnah and the practice of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of these ignorant people? It doesn't matter if they dislike me picking up food from the floor. This is the way of my beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I will practice it. Similarly, another Sahabi radiallahu anhu, companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once he went to one of the kings, Kisra, as far as I remember, and when he went there, he went there and he wanted to sit down on the chair. So when he was just about to sit down, he saw the chair was made out of gold. So he quickly moved away from there and sat on the floor. So the king said to him that, look, you know, why do you leave something, أَكْرَمْنَاكَ بِهِ, we've honored you with something, you know, why do you leave that and sit on the floor? He said that I've seen, and we have been told by our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we should not sit and use gold, we should not sit on it. Therefore I leave this. And even regarding Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, the great Khalifa and the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once they were on a travel, on a journey, they were going to Sham. In those days, Sham was not just Syria, but many parts of the Arab world, which was Jordan, Syria, Turkey, Lebanon, etc. So when they were traveling, he was with another companion, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah, radiallahu anhu majma'in. So he said to him, he sat on the horse, and when he came off the horse, Umar radiallahu anhu, he took his socks and he put it on his shoulder, and he started walking. So Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah, radiallahu anhu majma'in, the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him that when we go to these non-Muslims, they will dislike this. They will think low of you. They will degrade you. That this person is the Amir or the Khalifa of the Muslimin, and he's Amirul Mu'mineen. And look at him. Look at his clothing. Look, he's wearing, putting, taking his socks and putting on his shoulders. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he looked at Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu, and he said to him that, look, لو يقول ذاك غيرك جعلته نكالا. Now if somebody else would have said this, then I would have really taught him a lesson. He said to Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah radiallahu anhu, he said, if somebody else would have said this, then I would have taught him a lesson. He said that we will not leave something. We had no respect before coming into Islam. In the days of Jahiliyyah, in the days of paganism, in the days of ignorance, we had no respect. But Allah gave us respect with this religion. And this is a religion in which Allah gave us respect by following the ways of the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we follow him. And we don't look at what the non-Muslims do. So this celebration of Valentine's, as I mentioned, has a connection. And this, what they do, first of all, you know that it's a commercial practice. It's all commercialized, and the main objective, purpose, and goal behind it is just commercial gain. And this is something which is also in itself, which is totally against Islam. This is like, you know, send gifts once a year, and then the other days of the year, you know, forget about if it's your legal wife. We're not talking about illegal, but legal wife. Even Islam doesn't teach you that just, you know, once in a while. Islam, the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam given in many hadith is that, and if you look at the hadith literature and also in the Quran, there is so much emphasis on male husband and wife relationship. Allah says in the Quran, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, make sure that you stay and treat your wives in a proper, correct manner. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, اِسْتَوْصُوا بِالنِّسَاءِ خَيْرًا, that I am advising you that you should look after your wives properly. Regarding the woman, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that إِذَا الْمَرْأَةُ إِذَا صَلَّتْ خَمْسَهَا وَصَامَتْ شَهْرَهَا وَأَحْسَنَتْ فَرْجَهَا, that if a woman, if she prayed a five-time prayer and she kept her sawm and fasting in the month of Ramadan, and she guarded her modesty, وَأَطَاعَتْ زَوْجَهَا, and she obeyed her husband, دَخَلَتْ الْجَنَّةَ مِنْ أَيِّ أَبْوَابٍ شَاءَتْ, that she will enter into paradise from whichever door she wishes and wants. Another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which she says, الدُّنْيَا كُلُّهَا مَتَاعٌ وَخَيْرُ مَتَاعِ الدُّنْيَا الْمَرْأَةُ الصَّالِحَةُ, that the world is, all of it is something which you can take benefit of, and the best thing in the world is a pious woman. Also in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, أَكْرَمُكُمْ أَكْمَلُكُمْ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنُكُمْ خُلُقًا, the best, or the person who has the most complete iman and belief is the person who has the best manners, best character. وَخِيَارُكُمْ خِيَارُكُمْ لِنِسَائِكُمْ, and the best amongst you is the one who is the best with his wife. وَأَنَا خِيَارُكُمْ لِنِسَائِي, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says regarding himself, he says that I am the best from amongst all of you, I am the best with my wife. I treat my wife the best. In another hadith, similar meaning, he says that أَنَا أَخْيَرُكُمْ لِنِسَائِي, that I am the best with my wife from all of you, amongst you. So this is something in Islam. Islam does not restrict, as you say, that in many of these traditions, and this is where bid'ah comes from also, that they are just restricted to a particular date once a year, whereas Islam refuses this kind of custom and practice that you just restrict a particular thing to one day. It should be always throughout your life. You should always follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the guidelines set down by sharia. And in conclusion of the whole talk is that we should try our utmost best to follow the ways of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a perfect example for us, as Allah mentions in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a perfect best example for you. You don't need to look anywhere else. You don't need to look at the kuffar. You don't need to look at the non-believers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best example for you. There's a hadith mentioned in Shama'il of Imam al-Tirmidhi that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once, and this is something which people disregard, you know, don't take regard of this, but once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking and he saw a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he saw him that his trousers was below his ankles. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, he called him and he said, irfa' al-izaraka, that raise your trousers. Now, I'm not talking about here, is it compulsory or not compulsory, with pride or without pride. There's a difference of opinion between the scholars. Some scholars say that if it's with pride, then it's prohibited. Without pride, it's okay, below the ankles. Others say that all times it is prohibited, but this is something, different of opinion, and we respect all opinions. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, irfa' izaraka, that raise your trousers, and this person, he looked back, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, innaha burdatul maliha, it's just a normal kind of garment I have, there is not, it's not really expensive. So the Prophet ﷺ, the companion was trying to say that this is not something which is very expensive and that I should, you know, take care of. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him that, أَمَا لَكَ فِيَ أُسْوَةَ, don't you have in me a perfect example, haven't you seen? So this companion, he said that I looked at the izar and the garment of the Prophet ﷺ, فَنَظَرْتُ فَإِذَا إِزَارَهُ إِلَى نِصْفَ سَاقَيْهِ, I saw the izar and the garment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was halfway between his knees and his ankles. So this is the way and method. Now, these are the sunnah. Some sunnah are adiya, some are sunnah mu'akkada, ghair mu'akkada. Regardless whether this sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is necessary or it is not necessary, or it was, if a person loves another person, then regardless, you don't ask that is it compulsory or not compulsory. I mean, we don't say that, okay, you are doing haram or fisq or etc. This is between you and Allah. But this is just as from a love point of view, when a person loves another person, then as the famous Majnun, Layla and Majnun, the famous two people in early times in Arabs, the Majnun who used to love Layla so much that what he used to do, that he used to go and kiss and the walls of the house of Layla, and he used to do tawaf. And he go round in circles of his house. أَمُرُّ عَلَى الدِّيَارِ دِيَارِ لَيْلَى وَأُقَبِّلُ ذَا الْجِدَارِ وَذَا الْجِدَارَ. That if he says that I go around the house of Layla and I kiss the walls. وَمَا حُبُّ الدِّيَارِ شَغَفْنَ قَلْبِي وَلَكِنْ حُبُّ مَنْ سَكَنَ الدِّيَارَ. It's not these walls which I like and love. It's the person who lives inside the house who I love. Similarly, there's another poet who says that لَوْ كَانَ حُبُّكَ صَادِقًا لَأَطَعْتَهُ. That if your love is really and truly for the person who you love, if you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you truly say, we all say we love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but if we are, I mean, everybody can make a claim, we all make claims, okay, we love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and everybody does, I'm not saying, I mean, everybody does love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one way or another. This will be evident in a way, if you come to a Muslim and you say to him, if somebody comes to a Muslim, all of us here, and somebody swears, wal-iyadu billah, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will, any Muslim, even with a weak iman, will be ready to give his life for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So love, everybody has, but there are different stages and categories of love. So the person who loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more, he claims that he loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but there is no obedience, there is no following of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this person says, لَوْ كَانَ حُبُّكَ صَادِقًا لَأَطَعْتَهُ. If your love was really true, you would have obeyed him. إِنَّ الْمُحِبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. Now that person who loves another person, he follows him and he obeys him and follows his ways and his methods and his practice and his custom. So in conclusion, time is up, brothers. This day, as I explained in the beginning, that Valentine's Day has a connection with the kuffar, with the Christians. As I mentioned, it's through the time, the history, and we all know the history, you know history more better than me. I don't need to go into the history. And because it has a connection of the kuffar, this has come, and this not just in Muslims in this country. I mean, I lived in the Arab world for some time, and I saw in some countries in the Arab world that sometimes they celebrate this in some of the Muslim countries more than the kuffar celebrated in England. I mean, I was amazed. I was in Syria and also in Jordan. I saw, but more particularly when I was in Syria, I saw on the 14th of February that the Muslims were celebrating this day, and I was amazed that I have not even seen this much celebration in Leicester, in England. So sometimes the kuffar, when they see something coming from the west, they take it more than the kuffar themselves celebrate it. So this is something which we need to abstain from, refrain from, educate our brothers and sisters, Muslims, that we need to not take the customs of the kuffar, not have this love which we have. I mean, Islam is, we should have respect with Islam, we should have love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not and that does not mean that we don't make friendship with the kuffar. I mean, as the ulama say, that there is a certain time Islam allows you to do business with the kuffar. Islam allows you to keep a certain distance, to a certain degree, need to live with them, so you can keep friendship. But you don't have love for them from the heart, and you don't follow their practices, their customs, because with the intention, because you want to be like them. And we should follow the ways of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. The best example for us is the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا. And with this, وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي خلق الإنسان وقد أتى عليه حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا فسواه وعدله وعلى كثير ممن خلق فضله فجعله سميعا بصيرا ثم هداه السبيل ونصب له الدليل إما شاكرا وإما كفورا أما الكافرون فأعتد لهم سلاسل وأغلالا وسعيرا يعذبون بأصناف من العذاب ينادون ويلا ويدعون ثبورا وأما الشاكرون فكرمهم ونعمهم ولقاهم نظرة وسرورا فسبحان من بيده ملكوت كل شيء لم يزل ولا يزال عليما قديرا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله أرسله الله تعالى إلى العالم كله بشيرا ونذيرا اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد صلاة وسلاما دائمين متلازمين إلى يوم الدين وأوصيكم أيها المسلمون ونفسي المذنبة بتقوى الله تعالى أما بعد فيا عباد الله قد نهى الله تعالى المسلمين عن التشبه بالكفار وعن التصدق بالكفار يقول الله تعالى في محكم تبيانه يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا بطانة من دونكم لا يألونكم خبالا ودوا ما عنتم قد بدت البغضاء من أفواههم والبطانة كما يقول العلماء والمفسرون هو من الباطن ومن البطن والبطانة هو صاحب السر والذي يعرف الأمور الداخلية ويقول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام فيما روى عنه الإمام الترمذي في سننه من تشبه بقوم فهو منهم وقال أيضا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المؤمن أو المرء مع من أحب يوم القيامة وقال تعالى ولن ترضى عنك اليهود ولا النصارى حتى تتبع ملتهم قل إن هدى الله هو الهدى فيجب على المسلم دائما أن يقتدي ويتأسى بنبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم وله فيه أسوة مباركة كما قال تعالى لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر فينبغي له أن يقتدي بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والصحابة رضي الله عنهم أجمعين كما روى الإمام الترمذي في شمائله أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مرة كان في الطريق فقال لأحد أصحابه ارفع إزارك فقال الصحابي التفت فرأيت أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لي ارفع إزارك فقلت إنها بردة ملحة فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أما لك في أسوة وروي عن سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه أنه قال قد أكرمنا الله تعالى بالإسلام فمهما نبتغي العز بغير الإسلام أذلنا الله تعالى. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه. الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تعالى وقد أمرنا في كتابه إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت وباركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والكفرة والمشركين. اللهم انصر المسلمين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم إنا نجعلك في نحورهم ونعوذ بك من شرورهم. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا ولمشايخنا ولوالدينا ولإخواننا الحاضرين ولسائر المسلمين. والحمد لله رب العالمين. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وقيم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح. قد قامت صلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
Make sure the rows are straight, inshallah. The brothers can come and fill the space there. Fill in the gaps. If there's a gap in the soft before you, don't leave a space for shaytan. صَوْ اسْتَقِيمُوا وَاَعْتَدِلُوا صَوْ صُفُوفَكُمْ رَحِيمُكُمْ اللَّهُ. Allahu Akbar. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى. سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية وجوه يومئذ خاشعة عاملة ناصبة تصلى نارا حامية تسقى من عين آنية ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مصفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله استغفر الله
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا المرسلين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي رب زدني علما اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. One of the questions here, which one of the brothers that we gave, can a brother please guide his tent, please? There's a question here that somebody is asking that what is the difference between raising hands? Some people raise their hands in prayer and other people don't raise their hands in prayer. You see some Muslims, you know, when they go into the fear of Allah, they raise their hands and others don't. You know, what's the right position and what's the wrong position and why some people do it and others don't do it? The answer to this question is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he performed his salah in different ways, different methods and different ways of performing salah. There are hadith narrations mentioned from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in which he raised his hands in prayer, mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, etc. There are also hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not raise his prayer. So both ways are perfectly permissible, both ways are perfectly okay, totally acceptable. And according to the Hanafi fiqh, it is better, perhaps preferred, not to raise your hands, but to raise is also permissible. According to the other schools of thought, like Shafi'i, Maliki, and Hanbali, it is better to raise your hands, but not to be also perfectly okay. But there's no big difference of opinion. Therefore, if a Hanafi raises his hands in prayer, there's no problem. And this is, so some people think that's wrong, but it's not a problem, which is perfectly okay. The discussion here during Salah is it permissible to move to the left, right, forward to fill the space, according to the Hanafi fiqh. That's regarding Hanafi. The answer to this, please, can you just kindly be quiet that way you lose your servant to raise it? And the brothers are fishing, come get closer. You know who's sitting or who's not sitting. Can you move to a space near the tent salah and can you move one foot ahead? Can you, if it's permitted as Jarid, as long as we take one big step or take two steps with something in between? Okay? Take one step and then move, stop for a while, and then take another step. Or take one big step. As not to make Amal Kathir love walking, etc. in prayer. When nikah is performed and both people involved stay at home separately, do the parents need to know of the nikah as they act by being Muslims and give blessings? There are the rules and regulations for these kinds of nikah. As you know, nikah, marriage in Islam, it has the arkan, the necessary things of nikah, the hijab and qabul, accepting and offering. The man or the husband accepts and the wife offers, or vice versa. This is totally necessary. And then number two is the witnesses, okay, the shahidin. These are also necessary. Three things, acceptance, offering, and two witnesses are essential part of nikah. If this is done, nikah is done. Mahar and dowry is not, nikah does not depend on it. Although if you have to give it, but it does not depend on it. And according to the Hanafi fiqh also, it is not necessary for the parents to know also. If a girl gets married without the consent of a guardian of her parents, or parents, and it's done with a compatible person, her husband is compatible and similar to it, and this long detail in the book of fiqh, then it is perfectly okay and totally permissible for her to stay in the nikah and neither do the parents need to know. But it is recommended that you don't do that, because in the other hand, other three schools of thought, without the permission of the qadi and the wali, nikah will not be valid. So therefore, it's better to take the permission and with the consent of the guardian. The secret marriage is, and according to Hanafi, I just want to say that it is better to. And when people do this in haste, you know, then they have problems afterwards. You know, they think, they don't think, they fall in love in 2 days. and then after that they won't get married, and then after another 2 days, they've never hated that person more than before. So this is, just hate. Try to stay, before you get married, it's a big step in your life. It's not something which is easy. Take the mashwara and take the guidance and opinion of hundreds of people before you get married. What kind of background of the particular woman or the particular boy or the girl, what background she has, how she thinks, you need to do your homework before you get married. Never hasten towards getting married. And because of not, and also, this is one thing I heard from one of the scholars, that because of actually a lot of people have problems in marriage. Why? Because the Muslims, the people who get married, they don't even know the rules and the ahkam of Sharia regarding marriage. There's a lot of ignorance because of deen. Now we see the problems between husband and wife, there's big argument, debate, dispute, and there's so many divorces nowadays. And then there's arguing between the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law, and between this person and that person, and between the family of the husband and the family of the wife, and between the sister-in-law, and there's so many different disputes and arguments, to name just a few. The reason behind this, or the solution behind this, is that people are ignorant about the religion. Before getting married, they should learn about the rights. That these are the rights. From an Islamic perspective, even according to the Hanafi, a woman is not compelled, it's not compulsory on a woman to cook for her husband. It's not compulsory. If she says, I don't want to cook, you have to give provide me for the food, and you have to do that. Go to the takeaway. Go to the soon and bring the food. You have to go to pizza and bring the pizza. You have to provide. She says, no, I don't want to cook for you. That's her right. If she says, I want a separate house, then she can demand for a separate place where not a separate house altogether in a different city in London. She can't demand for that. But she can demand for a separate place where nobody comes to her belongings, and she has a separate key for that, separate place to cook, separate bathroom, children, etc. That's her right. You have to do so. By law, by Sharia, which is binding upon your husband, that he has to provide a wife with a separate living place. If she doesn't have to cook for the husband, where did the ruling come up cooking for the father and mother-in-law? That's out of the question. But on the same time, we say to her, look, if you saw, and that's the hadith which I just recited in khutbah, that if a woman, she prays the fasting prayers, and she gives the fasting of Ramadan, and she obeys her husband, and she guards the modesty, enters the palace with whichever rule she wishes. So you tell her, look, there's a lot of reward in respecting your husband, and looking after your husband, and doing khidmah of your husband, and looking at his parents, of course, and looking at anybody, but it's not compulsory. If she knows that, look, this is not necessary, she will do it more willingly. And if the parents, her father-in-law, mother-in-law, they don't expect from her that she has to do it, if they know that it's not compulsory, whatever she does, even if she did a bit, this is something really good, it's a favor from her, then what will they do? They will value it. With this, what will happen? There will be no arguments and debate. So we need people to know the rights of the husband, the rights of the wife, and she has, non-Muslims, as long as the Quran is saying that, not non-Muslims, they have a court, the Christians, and before getting married, you have a 5-month, 6-month court. These are the ways of staying in a marriage. I think you should have that also, I'm not saying a good thing. You should have that now, but before you get married, when you get married, what will you do? This proper 2-3 month course, and I'll learn about how to treat your wife, and also from the sister, how to respect and treat your husband, and what are your rights, what are his rights. And also, like a lot of people ask about things connected to the bedroom, so you can talk about that also, So, inshallah, that'll be a good idea. Before you get married, you should learn about the ruling of nikah. There's one question here, we'll end with this, we need to go over. Can you use toiletries or, deodorant and sexual with alcohol? As you know that all these creams, deodorants, perfumes, they all have alcohol. And most of these perfumes, etc., they have synthetic alcohol. Which means that according to Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Abu Yusuf, alcohol, that alcohol which is taken from dates and from grapes and barley, not in dates and grapes, that is totally known as khamar, purely nebulous impure. Besides that, taken out from other things, according to Imam Abu Hanifa and Abu Yusuf, is that to drink that much amount which does not intoxicate you, is permissible. You can get that. Whereas Imam Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani, he was of the opinion, along with Imam Shafi'i and Imam Malik and Imam Ahmad and others, which is a more preferred opinion and a more muftabi, the fatwa is on this opinion, even the Qur'anic Hadith matter, is that you can't even have the accountability of giving a drug. Qadidu wa qadidu wa drug. So to take it orally is totally impermissible, but the scholars of this time, they have given the fatwa just as the, not orally take it concerned, but to use the that alcohol, which is not made out of grapes and dates, okay, and barley, besides these things, and if it's used just externally, then they've given the permission that it is permissible. And if you look at all these deodorants, perfumes, etc., it's synthetic alcohol, and the alcohol is not made out of grapes, not made out of dairy, it is not the khamr, which is totally surely filthy and magic, no, it's the other one, so, you know, you can use it. But what is the goal is that whether it's permissible and if a person wears that and performs it for us, then should be okay, inshallah, and Qur'an will be valid. So inshallah, these are the few questions. There's one more question I can just make a start. Regarding asking about what is your comment on women singing naat and reciting Qur'an in public, recitation or releasing albums, etc. This was a question which I answered. As you know, I don't know if you, I have a website also. Instead of here, you can also come here and listen to the answers here. There's a website, inshallah, I'll tell you. I'll try it down there. It's darulifta.co.uk. darulifta.co.uk. I have a poster also. Now, like in the timing where people come between 6 and 8, I see a place not to answer questions or whatever. Now, people come with the inheritance, so we can calculate for them. We don't charge anything, it's free of charge. And between 6 and 8, the phone number also, between 6 and 8. There's a whole post that I forgot to bring it to you. I was going to, yeah. So people, sometimes people phone, especially the sisters, because there's no accommodation for the sisters to come, you know, personally. Because there's no accommodation there. So the sisters usually phone, but the brothers and the nurse, they come. And so I also have a website, which is, a lot of people ask questions on there. The same, even the European one, I just answered, I think, last week. In detail, and there's more detail in there. In fact, each answer is long detail. Then there as well, the answer was that there's a lot of verses, you can use that in fact, about the two pages. There's a lot of verses which, for example, Allah says in Surah Al-Ahzab, what does it say? That don't be soft. He addresses the women, that do not be soft in tone while she's speaking to men. It is permissible. So a woman, you know, with full observance with ahkam and the laws of hijab, to talk and converse with men, talk with a hijab, it's permissible. To talk, and the voice of a female is not considered an awra, it's not considered as a part which needs to be concealed. It's not considered as an awra. But Allah says here that do not speak with non-mahram males, foreign males, you know, meaning those people who are not the mahram, in a sweet, soft tone. فَيَسْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٍ. That person who has sickness, disease, illness in his heart, you know, he's easily provoked. This person, what will he do? He will incline towards me. And if you look at, you know, like everybody knows the common fact, common knowledge, that the voice of a woman, you know, has a great say. And this is why music, it has a great say in provoking the sexual appetite of a man. You know, it provokes his sexual desire, his lust, his passion. So this is common knowledge, we don't need to, you know, explain this. But because of this, when a woman or a female, when she prays na'am, you know, or prays anashid, when she sings, or she recites the Qur'an, or even tafsir or qira'ah, in the presence, if it's just women, no problem. Perfectly okay, permissible, rather she's doing women. But if she does that, in front of non-mahram, it is not permissible. The question is all the fuqaha. Because Allah clearly said, فَيَتْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ أَخْضَعْنَا بِالْقَوْلِ فَيَتْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٌ. So, I think, you know, and this is in presence of men, non-mahram, and also by releasing albums and cassettes. Why? Because these albums, you know, we have certain sites on the internet, you know, like, especially from Pakistan and India, I don't know India, but Pakistan, not the only women playing those sorts of Urdu, not, you know, like singing. It's not permissible. For men also to listen to that is not permissible. Okay? So also for females, it's not permissible for them to do that. They should abstain from it and refrain from it, inshallah. Then we just rock it out and handle that for the release of the human. Thank you.